Good morning, everyone. This is Brother Lloyd. And to those who are keeping the Sabbath today, peace and blessings as always. Now, today's lesson is titled Mystery, and that's simply because I came across a couple of scriptures which pretty much read the same, but for one, it made 100% total sense, but for the other, it seemed to be a total contradiction based on where it was in scripture. So I had to go on a mission to dig and search and find out what the true answer is. And it became a true mystery because I was at a loss and I put it off for a while. And then one day it prompted me again and I came back to it and I kept digging and searching, like the word says, to prove all things. And I think I've come up with the answer that is satisfactory to this mystery. Now, this was all preceded by a teaching I was watching a couple months back, where an individual was trying to prove that through his evidence, he was trying to prove that there's a superior alien race which had placed us here, Adam and Eve, and also that he had placed, or this superior being or race had placed people here prior to Adam and Eve. And that was part of the intriguing thing, but my attention span is extremely short for teachings that take several hours. And then it takes you several other videos which are 1.5 to 2 hours long. I don't have an attention span that long, because to me it just serves to sway you into a world of contradiction based on what you already believe. And this is what I already believe, so I'm not going to subject myself to hours upon hours of so-called evidence and in the end be lost in a world of confusion, because it should be a whole lot simpler to be able to prove what you have to say if you have the evidence. So I choose to stick by the Father and His Word. And with that, let's go to Deuteronomy 29:29. And it tells us what it reads. It says, "The secret things belong unto the Lord our God, but those things which are revealed belong unto us and to our children forever, that we may do all the words of His law." Look, the Father gives us what He gives us, and not everything. He gives us what He gives us for our benefit now. See, we have to formulate a character and nature about us that will ultimately give us access to all the things that we have questions about. See, you can spend your whole life here ignoring this and chasing all of that, which you're never going to find a true answer to. And you can't get so caught up in what man says or what someone constructs or science and all these things. Everything is revealed or given by the Heavenly Father, and He gives what He gives. Science, whatever man has created through science, has been given by inspiration of whom? The Father, through the Holy Spirit. See, some people are endowed with knowledge and understanding to be creative enough to come up with some of these things, and there are plenty who take it and twist it with the help of the enemy to come up with things contrary to that. Remember, like I always say, whatever the Father has allowed or given to someone to be creative with, the enemy creates a counterfeit. None of it comes by any other means than through the Father. Man comes up with nothing on his own that isn't inspired by the Father or given by the enemy. So, Deuteronomy 29:29 tells us about the secret things. See, the Father addresses it right at the root. So anything contrary to that, already know that the Father's addressed it. Now, in Genesis 9:1, it reads, it says, "And God blessed Noah and his sons and said unto them, Be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth." Hold on to this scripture. This is one of the two scriptures I was talking about. He told Noah and his sons to be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. Now, we know this was all in response to what? The flood, because the Father had wiped everything out by water. Now, we know that Noah and his family were what? They were the only 8 souls left. So the Father charged them with the task of replenishing or filling the earth again with human life. It's simple and clear, and I don't think anyone's going to argue that, right? Okay, so first let's look up the word replenish. The word replenish means to make full or complete again, as by supplying what is lacking. And what was lacking at this time was what? Mankind. So the Father charged them with the task of refilling this planet with mankind. It also means to supply, or to fill again or anew. So it's all the same thing. So we're clear. To replenish means to do it again, fill it back up, resupply it. Now, the etymology of this word is from the early 1300s to 1350. It's a Middle English word. So now we know where this word originated, in the early 1300s, and it's a Middle English word, replenish. Now, hold on to that information as we move forward to the next part. Genesis 1:28 reads like this, and this is in reference to Adam and Eve. It reads, it says, and God blessed them. Does that sound familiar? Just like he blessed Noah and his family. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and every living thing that moveth upon the earth. So this is what the Father told Adam and Eve, almost verbatim as to what he told Noah and his family. Now, so obviously you caught what the problem was or what the mystery is. He said, and bless them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it. Now, this was the basis of part of that teaching that I was telling you about, that the individual was giving based on this phrase, replenish, in this scripture. Why would the Father tell Adam and Eve to replenish something that allegedly had never been done before? He told Noah and his family because it had already been done before and they needed to redo it. So this created the mystery in Genesis 1:28 for the word to say replenish. How is this so? This is truly a mystery in scripture, maybe that we're not privy to understand. And that bothered me that, man, all this time I missed that. Now, mind you, I use an 1843 version of the King James. And the 1611 also reads the same. They both say replenish. So the question for me became, is there truly a mystery in Genesis 1:28 in which Adam and Eve are being told to do something which had been done before, as Noah and his family in Genesis 9:1 were told to do something which I know from reading was done before? And I didn't have an answer for this question, but I wanted an answer and I couldn't find one, so I let it go. But 1 Thessalonians 5:21 came to mind, and it says what? To prove all things and hold fast to that which is good. So I kept digging and searching, and then I recall the etymology of the word, which is a 1300s word. And so I pondered on that. I said, okay, I know this is the early English word from the Middle English word from the 1300s. And I said, well, my scriptures, my King James Version is 1843 version as opposed to a 1300s version. So I said, okay, well, let me do this. Let me look at some other scriptures. Let me look at some other versions. Well, I looked at the 1611 King James, and it also says replenish. Okay, so I kept digging and searching, and then I came up with this. So I kept digging and searching, and I was led to my 1560 Geneva Bible, which the King James Version was derived from, or which it was basically translated from or written from based on the 1560. And I found my answer. The 1560 Geneva reads like this. It says, and God blessed them, and God said to them, bring forth fruit and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and rule over the fish of the sea and over the fowls of the heaven and over every beast that moveth upon the earth. So now I know that the word replenish is a change from the 1560 Geneva Bible from which it was derived. And now that gives me a semblance to what my answer is. So now I said, okay, I'm going to look in some of the other versions of the scriptures, which are all more modern than the 1843 King James. But the majority of everything I read did say fill. So that's one change that didn't follow through through most of these translations. But understand that the even newer versions after 1843 have so many changes that you're losing a lot of referencing, and references and different things are totally removed. So I'm not swayed by any means to use anything more modern, put in even simpler English. Now, when you look at this, we're going from 1560 to the 1843, and one little word was changed from fill to replenish, and you see the chaos and confusion that it can cause. Now, if you go from the 1843 to the 2014, which I'm sure some of you got one for Christmas, can you imagine all the words that have been changed, the context, the meaning, and the confusion that it can lead when you compare this to something more authentic as opposed to what you have today? It can be very confusing, and it can lead you into a world of chaos and maybe not understanding. So, in a simple sense, we have to understand that the older the scriptures are, the more authentic they are. And that's with anything in life. The older something is, the more authentic it is. We call them antiques, but they're more original than the more modern stuff. Now, some of these modern things always appear and seem to be better, but even in the world, some of the modern, whatever it is, bears no comparison to the durability of the original. We have to remember, people, that we get all knowledge, wisdom, and understanding from heaven above. And finally, Philippians 4:8 reads like this. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things. These are the things, people, that we need to focus on. And I just gave you one example of a simple word change from 1560 to 1843. Fill to replenish. And the chaos and mysteries that they can create in our own mind. Now, keep in mind, too, if we don't dig and search to prove things like this, we can be led astray by teachings of others trying to teach us that there's something far superior and far better than the Heavenly Father and what He says in His Word. And that's simply not true. This is Brother Lloyd. And as always, remember, move your toes out the way, put your feelings to the side, and focus and listen to the Father's Word. And then deal with it as you may. He gives us free will. This is Brother Lloyd. I'm out.